Taking a step back from analyzing individual defenses, it's important to understand the actual Bitcoin network itself. After all, as we saw with Publish or Perish, which sounded really awesome in theory, it ultimately fails to work in practice due to assumptions about certain properties about the Bitcoin network, particularly that of synchrony. So first off, the Bitcoin network is peer-to-peer, and there's no central entity sending or receiving messages for us. The way that messages get sent around the network is through a gossip protocol, which is also called flooding. Basically, if I want to send out a transaction, I have to tell all the nodes I'm connected to, which we call my neighbors. All of my neighbors tell their neighbors, and their neighbors tell their neighbors, and so on. For example, if the network actually looked like this, and I wanted to send a message to Nick, I would tell my neighbors Derek and Gloria. Derek and Gloria would then tell their neighbors, and thankfully, Derek is connected to Nick, so Nick gets my message. Also, one note is that as we discussed in the Bitcoin Mechanics module, my message would be digitally signed. The way you get connected and join the Bitcoin network in the first place is by a recursive procedure. Hard-coded into the Bitcoin core software is a list of seed peers that you connect to initially. You ask these seed nodes for their neighbors, pick some, ask these nodes for their neighbors, and repeat until you think you have a fairly random set of connections. Bitcoin allows each node to have a maximum of 125 connections, and generally, you have 8 outbound and 117 inbound connections. To further understand how information propagates through the Bitcoin network, we have to understand the network topology and latency. Network topology means how the Bitcoin network would look if you were to graph it out like we've been doing with circles for individual nodes and lines for connections between nodes. In Bitcoin, we want an even topology. We want each node to have roughly the same weight, mining power in our case, have random connections, and look fairly uniform. But this isn't really the case. As we know, there's a huge difference in mining power node to node. This means that some nodes are more influential than others. So is the Bitcoin network truly as decentralized and distributed as we thought? Nope. Let's say Derek has an incredibly high hash rate. It could be that he's running a mining farm or a pool. We can't really tell, since mining farms and pools sometimes want to remain secret so people don't attack them. Derek is arguably more influential than other nodes in the network. Compare his hash power with someone who's just hanging around as an SPV node, or a node that's just a solo miner. Derek's pool has a lot more hash power than any of these. And there's no easy way of determining the network topology. If Derek is running a mining pool, his miners don't have to be directly connected on the Bitcoin network at all. They could just be connecting to Derek directly through some lightweight protocol. So all of Derek's miners form a secret subgraph, essentially. And it turns out that due to this hidden graph topology, and the fact that Derek could be multiple nodes on the network, possibly running multiple mining pools, Derek could potentially hide the fact that he has more than 50% of the network hash power. And scarier yet, Derek doesn't even need 50% of the network hash power. As we saw with the attacks and defenses previously, Bitcoin suffers from some incentive alignment problems, especially in the case of selfish mining. As it turns out, the Bitcoin network could be in jeopardy if Derek's pool, or pools, had 33% of the network hash rate, or 25%, or 23.2%, or 32%. Perhaps there's an attack or selfish mining scheme that hasn't been discovered yet that lowers the profit threshold even lower. In addition to network topology, we also have to worry about network latency. As we saw in Publish or Perish, a selfish miner could publish his secret blocks right before it's too late. Some nodes would see it as in time, and others would see it as late. And that's a pretty good example for how network latency is an issue here. Also, consider the case where two miners find a valid block at the same time. There's a race to propagate, like before, and the miner who is better connected in the network and has a faster propagation time would ultimately win. This leads to disproportionate profits in miners. Miners who are better connected in the network see things faster and are able to send out messages and blocks faster too. Meanwhile, it's possible that a poorly connected miner could spend all this time finding a block, and when it finally finds one, its propagation time could be so slow due to network latency that within that time, another miner would have already found and submitted a competing block to a majority of the network. And now for something even bigger. think back to the first module where we discussed Sybil attacks and how it's not beneficial to have more identities because in proof of work, we make computational power the limiting factor. Well, if we're clever enough, we can launch a Sybil attack in another kind of way, leveraging what we just went over, network topology and latency. Let's say Derek has the ability to flood the network with nodes. These could either be his miners, or if he's clever enough, he could even write malware that makes victims' computers act like zero-power nodes, just sitting there listening to the Bitcoin network and relaying information back to Derek. They'd act like sensors. Derek could Sybil attack honest miners by leveraging his network-level dominance. Let's say Derek is also selfish mining and already has some secret blocks which are distributed to all of his zero-power nodes. When Derek's nodes hear about the next honest block X, Derek could ignore X and publish his own secret block, P. If block P reaches a miner before block X, then the miner by default mines on block P. So in this attack, Derek leverages both the network latency and topology. Derek is well connected and has less latency, and is able to propagate his secret block P faster than if he only had control of one node. He also has his unique ownership of the network topology, since he owns a lot of nodes around the network, and also since he has a large proportion of the network mining power. So as a closing note, know that outside of what we just presented in this module, there are still a lot of attacks and defenses, such as Eclipse attacks and stubborn mining, which take into account network latency, topology, and more.